Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Matt Taylor. Welcome again to Spitballing. I'm with my good buddy here,
Kyle Amundson.
And today we have Mr. Seth Doud in the house.
Have you guys ever had a friend that was so gifted and so talented that even though he's your friend and you love him, you also kind of hate him, you know, because you're jealous because of all of his abilities?
Well, that's how I feel about you, Kyle.
Well, you know, I was going to say, but, you know, maybe not. Maybe I'm just a petty motherfucker. But for me, that's Seth Doud. Thanks. So fucking gifted, so talented. It's, you know, he's just amazed me often, you know, just over the years. Yeah.
Shit. Well, thanks, man. There's lots of stuff you guys can do that I can't do as well, so.
Well, like
And someday I will figure out one of those things and I'll be good at something.
I could still kick your ass. So. Yeah.
All right. Thanks for having me. I'm excited
you
to be here.
Are welcome. We are super excited to have you. How's your week been, Kyle?
Well, the week has been great. I have something that's been frustrating me that maybe somebody out there can help me with, though. If you're familiar with the I did not want to bring this up. But it's been going on so long, and I'm at my wit's end looking for help on this in this matter. So the Walk a Mile in Her Shoes event that takes place in Baxter every year, I got a team together. We just kind of showed up in 2016 and did it. And then it's a great event. You know, the proceeds go to combat. Domestic violence, and I showed up with the team in 2016. We had a great time. It was a great event, very important, and ever since then I've wanted to put together a bigger team, and you know, and kind of have, you know, just and do better than we did the first time. The first time was great, but I wanted to put together a big team and support this cause. So 2017, you know, couldn't get a hold of anybody. Had some questions, couldn't get a hold of anybody. Whatever, event went without us. You know, we wrote it off. Then last year, I was a little more active, trying to get a hold of somebody. The website for the event and stuff like that. You know, send email, whatever. No response. This year, done the same thing. Emails. A Facebook message to the lady that's supposed to be coordinating it, maybe I'm getting bad information. Maybe these are all like dead end links or something like that. Because I don't. It's a great event. It's very important. But I feel like I'm really struggling. I need my questions answered, and the people that are like heading it up, I feel like maybe are snoozing on that. The organization that runs it, I'm not even going to mention their name. I feel like there's probably a lot of good people that work there. There's probably people there that, you know, that do the jobs of 10 people. But it seems like the people that I'm trying to get in touch with are doing the jobs of zero people. So I'm kind of pissed off about that because I want to, you know, I like it's a, this is, you know, something that I take seriously. It's a subject that's near to my heart, and I want to be a part of this event, and I know a lot of guys that are, you know, as soon as I put a thing on Facebook, you know, I had this tremendous outpouring, you know, all these guys are like, I'm in, count me in. So anyway, you know, we want in, you know, if there's anybody out there that can, you know, hit me up on Facebook, whatever, you know, get a hold of me through the show. However you know, I have questions. I need to get in touch with somebody that can help me out there. And fuck, you know, I mean, yeah.
So in 2016, did you guys like win the race then, or is that why there
is it? Are there winners in
it's
that
no, it's just a walk, and yeah, and it was really, and it was just good, man. It was a great environment, you know, great. It was a great atmosphere, a bunch of awesome people. I think your friend Troy,
Trifles,
yes,
yeah,
yeah, he was there. He's probably there every year. I know he's a community minded dude. You know, it was great. You know,
what is like, it like a mile?
Yeah, yeah. And heels are fucking hard to walk in.
You could probably walk a mile, Seth.
I don't know about in heels.
Man, it's brutal. Those things are difficult. Like, no, I you know, I see those.
You can you wear pumps or is it?
Well, basically,
I
like
think pumps are a form of heels, Matt. Okay. Aren't they?
I had to change. I don't know. I mean, I know, but I'm not saying. I didn't always. I've always worked in bars, but I wasn't always a bouncer.
I got a really sexy pair of like 6-inch stiletto heels. I could probably.
Well, I started off in some big ass heels, but then I tried to run in them. And fuck, so like I stopped and changed into some flats that I brought to finish it out. Yeah, it was.
Maybe you're too competitive, and that's.
I say we Viking this shit. I say we don't get a hold of anybody, but we still get a group of guys together, and then we don't just show up, but we fucking win that race. We Viking it. We Viking
like
the don't walk
like
a mile in her shoes.
I wanted to make some pay the iron price reference, but
right.
You know,
well,
we have
the
to support
iron
their
price.
Cause. So
well, whatever.
If you get an answer, let me know. I'll see if I'm around. I'll come join your team.
Right on.
That'd be very cool. I think that there is it's a weird thing, the whole you know, domestic violence issue. It's always so touchy, and people get so goddamn touchy about it. And it is an important issue. I've always wanted to do a really in-depth, like, kind of long-term, you know, course for women's self-defense, and I've written up a whole curriculum and whatever. But it's such a difficult subject because I'm not talking about, like, you know, situational awareness and make sure. No, I mean, I'm talking about, like, okay, shit's already gone bad, and now you're on the ground, the guy's trying to get your pants off, and now this is what you do. This is when all else has failed. So the hardest thing I've had is trying to come up with a name for it, you know, because I don't even like the phrase women's self-defense.
That's my purse. I don't know you. You see that?
Yeah. Well, one of the things, and I don't want to get too deep into this because I could talk about it forever, but one of the things that so many self-defense, especially women's self-defense courses talk about is like just, you know, like eye gouging and, you know, and biting and trying, you know, fighting with everything you got. And I feel like it is like the exact opposite of the correct approach. Like the correct approach is to de-escalate, to reduce damage, to try to survive of the period of time that you need to, and then if you get to the point where that's not a possibility anymore, then to take it to the next level. And I mean, I have a pretty in-depth thing about it, but I definitely have I've definitely had some resistance to it, and a lot of the resistance that I've got from people that I kind of view as pretty enlightened and pretty liberal, and it somehow comes off as I'm saying that. I mean, I have had people say to me, what are you saying that women deserve to be raped if they don't like know how to defend themselves? And it's such a crazy what I'm saying. That's pisses me off.
I think you're misunderstood a lot of the time with a lot of things.
I think I am too, Seth.
Well, and sometimes people that you expect to be you know, more like enlightened are the last people on earth you want to talk to about shit. So I told you that story about the girl that we grew up with.
Mm-hmm.
I was, you know, we were friends on Facebook and stuff, and you know, and she knew that I was like a big supporter of like, you know, gay and lesbian issues and stuff. You know, I quite literally fought, you know, over those issues,
right,
in the past. And and she was, you know, there was a conversation going on, her and some of her friends from the metro, and I you know, I asked a question because, you know, like I do the whole like trying to understand shit, you know, that I haven't quite figured out for myself thing. And I asked a question about white privilege because I was like, you know, I'm not quite 100% sure that I understand the whole concept, you know, like, you know, how would you describe, you know, like white privilege and stuff? And then the, like, you know, the Rainbow Coalition of, you know, woke, extra woke, ladies, fucking tore into me and, said all kinds of hateful, awful shit. And And then I got pissed off, and I'm like, you guys are bitches. Fuck you. Like, I was asking a question. You know, like, I can't, like, you know, where is this coming from? And then after I said that, then I was called a woman beater and a rapist and stuff like that. And I'm like, oh, geez.
Was this on Facebook by chance?
Yes, it was.
Sounds like it. I think it's hard to describe white privilege as someone that's always been white, just because it's like the normal, you know. It's you kind of got to step outside that box and think about, I mean, how every other race sees that, you know what I mean? I mean, you can have a pretty good grasp on what it is, and you can even like fight against it and stuff. But as a white person, I don't think you can ever really understand what it truly is.
You know,
I'm thankful I don't get shot when I get pulled over.
Last week we had a conversation with Ace, Kali. It was super, it was probably our best podcast today, but this one's going to blow it away. But it was really interesting talking to him. And that was, I mean, I think that was really kind of what I got out of it, was that it really is a privilege to, even though I fucking hate it when those cherries come on behind me, even though I know I'm not doing anything wrong, and even though I have insurance and I am not going, the worst thing that's going to happen is I'm going to get a ticket. That's privilege. I'm not afraid. I don't like it. It scares me when the cops pull me over, but I'm not afraid I'm going to get pulled out of the car and beat to death.
Sure.
And that's a privilege. And I think that's kind of how,
you know, and
that's just one tiny example of.
And I was, you know, looking for like these ladies, you know, feedback and stuff. And I was actually, I also waited for, you know, I was waiting for the girl that we grew up with, my friend, to chime in like on my behalf and say, you know, guys, settle down. Kyle's a good dude, you know. But no, she, you know, joined in with the rest of them. And, that's why, even though I obviously identify myself as a liberal, you know, there's liberals out there that I fucking hate.
For sure.
And I think about those, like I said, you know, like I've referred to them as like the extra woke flavor before, so fucking holier than thou and self-righteous and shit. I mean, way to win people over to your cause, because I wouldn't piss on any of those bitches if they were on fire. to be quite frank.
Sweet.
So I was bummed out about that, you know, and... so like a lot of times people that you expect to be like, you know, able to really like, you know, help you out, or people that you really you see as somebody that might be, you know, extra well versed in a topic or whatever. Yeah, maybe not necessarily the fucking people to talk to.
Right.
Just like what Matt was saying about the self-defense thing. And
yeah,
just
that's
like the way it's perceived.
Right. It's like, yeah. I mean, I remember a long time ago I put a post on Facebook and it was about a real incident that happened. It was this chick, and I believe she was in Afghanistan or might have been Iraq, but she was a Marine, and she was also a purple belt in jiu-jitsu, and she ends up getting on a bus and, whatever. She wasn't paying attention. Anyway, long story short, the bus driver drives her out in the middle of nowhere and attacks her and is trying to rape her, and she ends up triangling him and then breaking his orbital socket. And I was like, fuck yeah!
Yeah, dude.
You know?
For sure.
You know, woman power, you know, and I put that post on Facebook and I said something like, man, I really wish more women would take up jiu-jitsu because it's really hard to make a victim out of somebody who refuses to be victimized. And apparently, when you put that through the
woke filter?
The woke filter decoder ring, that translates as
victim blaming and them not being prepared.
That I think women need to be raped if they don't know how to defend. And it's the most frustrating viewpoint. Because, I mean, I've dedicated a good chunk of my life teaching people how to defend themselves, both men and women.
Well, and it sucks when your intentions are good and everything, and you've got somebody to like that tries to like hang you out, you know, because they want to appear more enlightened or like just a fucking more wonderful human being than you know, like that's tough.
I was having
that's why when I refer to those women as bitches, you know, I was talking specifically about the ladies that I talk to. I don't use that word a lot, but yes, indeed, I do maintain that those were bitches. So
right, I was having a really heated conversation. I don't remember how long ago it was, but it was with my girlfriend Meta and her friend Katie. So I'm just calling you out, Katie. I'm putting you on the spot right here. And that conversation just went really south. And it was like, there was some drinks involved, and they were definitely having some fun with me, you know. But it really was like, oh yeah, well, you know, like basically exactly that. Like you're saying women should be raped. And I really thought about it afterwards, and I was like, no, I totally didn't explain myself correctly. And then I thought of this analogy, and I don't know if it works or not, but like, it's kind of like The Walking Dead, right? Like, let's say, like that I think being a woman in like, I know I'm talking from this perspective of being a woman, but it's kind of like living in the world of The Walking Dead, and you just got to assume that fucking everybody's a zombie and is going to try to attack you. Well, if it's in the world of The Walking Dead and you don't know how to stick a knife in a zombie's head, well, then you're probably going to be a fucking zombie. I mean, that's that's the reality of it. So I don't think that's not a valid point. Learn how to stick a fucking knife in someone's head. That's it.
Yeah, I
think they agree with what you're saying. They just wish you'd say it different. I don't care how you say it, but I think...
Well, it sucks that you have to worry about that. I mean, just
it does. No, I get it.
My friend Steph, she tags me in something on Facebook, and she's like, this is a great... this is the shirt for you. And it was a cool shirt. It said, end rape culture, even if it costs you a couple friends, or something like that.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
And, I mean, this is someone that knows me well, that knows how I feel about shit, you know, that knows where I stand and stuff. And I was like, that is a great shirt. I'm like, oh, but if I wear that, you know, like, and I make, you know, any off-color comment or whatever, well, then people like, you know, what happened to me before, you know, like, you know, like, oh, fuck, you know, like, I got to worry about that shit. And I'm like, why am I, like, gun-shy about, like, even buying a shirt, like, wearing a shirt like that, you know, when, like, people that know me know, like, where I'm at with this shit, you know, but if I... You know, make some, you know, make like, then I have to be so fucking careful what I say. Like, I can't wear this shirt, you know?
I have a solution for you on that. So, what you need to do is you need to forfeit your right to your own wardrobe. Because that's what I've done.
I've seen that happen. I've seen that go poorly for people.
Well, today I am, I am sporting the Take Me to Your Beaver shirt. So
I didn't even read it.
So when we first started out, Kyle has great t-shirts. He's got a great t-shirt collection.
Yes,
and
yeah.
I was a little jealous, you know, and I was like, shit, I need to get myself some cool t-shirts. And I was bitching about it, about like how I got to go clothes shopping. And I just don't go clothes shopping. And Meta's like, oh, I'll get you t-shirts for the podcast. That has turned into, like, she's now, like, officially in charge of my wardrobe. And she, like, picks out a shirt for me every week and then gives it to me to wear. And I don't, and then she's like, well, you can, and I was like, okay, look, if you're going to do the job, then it's your job. I don't want any input. Like, so just give me the shirt and I'll fucking wear it. Well, now that's become a thing with her and her friends, and they're all like, I just can't imagine what kind of shirts I'm going to end up wearing. But fuck it. I'm in. Like, I pushed all my chips to the middle.
Man, I just got more in the mail yesterday, and I was, like, having trouble, like, trying to figure out what to go with today.
Yeah.
You know?
So I'm like Einstein. Not the smart part. Just the part where he, like, didn't...
Well, I was going to say, is it the messy hair?
Well, not quite that either. No, just the part where he didn't want to, like, make a decision on his wardrobe, so he just had, you know, all of the exact same suit.
Right? I didn't know that about Einstein.
Oh,
I
yeah, that's either. Very true. Yeah. Yeah. There's a great book called...
I didn't read it.
Fucking Einstein. I think it's called Fucking Einstein. So, there
was
might...
Was it written by a groupie? Is it one of those tell-alls or something? Like rock stars getting shit?
Like, being an Einstein groupie would be awesome. Like, what would that look like? So, there are probably a few of you out there in TV land, which is not an actual real place anymore, that probably don't know who Mr. Seth Doud is. I mean, there might be four. I don't know if anybody who...
Probably a lot.
Actually, well, maybe not in our viewership, but maybe. But if you don't know, Seth Doud is a very talented singer-songwriter who's been... playing, performing, rocking the world for, God, going on, what, 25 years?
Yeah, a little bit longer, maybe.
Yeah. And I first met Seth at the Eclectic Cafe, right?
Yeah, I was probably 14, 13, yeah. 15 at the most.
Yeah. And you couldn't play guitar yet. You were only playing a piano. Yeah, you hadn't learned to play guitar yet.
I played guitar a little bit. Just a little bit.
Did you ever even have any guitar lessons? Because I know you teach yourself to play shit. I know you taught yourself to play piano.
Yeah, I don't read music or anything like that.
And we get back to my hatred for you. Who does that?
This 14-year-old kid just had this fucking voice, this huge voice. And the Eclectic Cafe was some little coffee shop that I used to own. And music was like a kind of a big part of what like made that thing as, you know, as cool and semi-functional as it was. And you ended up kind of hooking up with some pretty amazing musicians.
Yeah, and I knew I wanted to be a musician before the Eclectic existed, but I don't think it, I mean, I can't guarantee it would have continued, especially I know it wouldn't have continued the way that it did if I didn't have that place to hone my skills and to cut my chops and to, you know, meet and play with people older than me, and it really helped, like, form, like, what I wanted to do for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
And so thank you for that.
Oh, yeah.
I know I've told you that before.
Well, you are welcome. And you,
we could smoke cigarettes in there. It was the best.
I remember one night, this wasn't that long ago actually, but I ran into you here at this bar, and I was not working. I was on the other side of the bar. And we were drinking. There was some drinking involved. And
a little bit.
The next day, I get a phone call from Angie Stevens.
Oh, she had?
And she's like, what the fuck were you and Seth doing last night? And I was like, Angie, how are you? I haven't talked to you in forever. And she's like, you guys fucking drunk called me. And I was like,
it was
we
your
did?
Idea. I forgot about that.
Angie
is another crazy talented musician.
Yeah, Angie is like next level.
And she, so apparently Seth and I, super wasted, talking about old times, talking about how great it was. We decided we would drunk call Angie.
Did she answer?
No, we just left her a message.
Yeah.
And she said, like, yeah, you left me like a 20-minute, like, completely drunk,
crying,
rambling,
crying,
laughing message. And I was like,
heard some shit break.
And I was like, oh, that kind of sounds like us. I can imagine that would happen.
Yeah, we don't get to hang out very often, so.
You and Angie, or me and
not
you?
Me and you.
Yeah.
I see Angie more than I see you at this
That's
point.
That's probably true.
Does she still live in Colorado?
Yeah, Denver. I was just with her and her husband. Over the 4th of July, we played down in Pensacola Beach. And we spent a week down there and a couple days in New Orleans.
Cool. Yeah, you're going all over the place now.
Yeah, this fall I'm hitting, Madison, Milwaukee, Chicago, Memphis, Nashville, Atlanta, Chattanooga, Savannah, all of Florida, the Keys.
Cleveland, Ohio.
No, I've been there and done that. I'll be back to Cleveland. I like Cleveland. But I won't sing.
Kyle, there will be no singing.
Fuck. I'm sorry. Sorry.
Jesus.
And there will be singing. It just won't be me doing it.
Right. Thank God. Actually, that's not even true. That's not even true. In this podcast, I promise you, Kyle will do a little more singing.
So will Matt.
Matt won't.
We'll figure out a good
cryptic
chord, a good harmony.
What
he doesn't.
About.
No, you don't.
It's
but
easy
you will.
To get me to sing, though.
Matt used to be in a band.
Oh my God! Shut up.
He was the singer.
They. So.
And your drummer rocked.
Rocked. Fuck. So that was the thing. So what it was?
God, he was so good. Is he still around playing drums, Mike?
Mike, no. You know.
I haven't thought about him in years.
His brother Chris every once in a while.
God, he was good.
We're friends.
He had a huge drum set too.
Yeah. So what it was back when we had the Eclectic, like, we would just collect all these fucking musicians. We, like, musicians would come out of the woodwork, and there was this band that was super, super good, super tight, but they didn't have a singer, and they were, like, I don't know how the fuck it happened, but I agreed.
Long story short, they never got a singer.
They didn't. I agreed to do some songs with them, and it was super, super fun.
Think about, like, Diet, Rage Against the Machine.
Yeah, well, we did a Rage song, and I remember, I can't remember that kid's name, but I mean, we had a couple shows and it was really fun, but I was up on stage and I'm just, fuck you, don't do it, you tell me, and I fucking front kicked this guy right in the head, and he goes flying backwards, and I was like, oh shit, and then he's like, yeah. it was pretty punk rock.
It had rock
it was pretty
soul.
Punk rock.
Rock and soul.
Yeah, God. Thanks
yeah,
for
I missed that place.
That.
Son's mom has a salon in that same spot now. It's so weird. Every time I walk in there, it's
really?
I can feel just all the energy. And I mean, I spent hours every day in that place.
You even were a barista at one time.
In high school. I worked there for a while.
Horseshit barista.
I thought I was pretty good.
You were there for 2 weeks.
I mean, I sucked at but I was good at making coffee when I came and did it and stuff.
Right, when you showed up.
Yeah.
Yeah, you weren't super good at showing up. But whatever.
I just wanted to work there because I liked it.
You did. You did. Yeah.
I still don't have any work ethic.
No.
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 You know.
I mean.
Thank God I only work 6 hours a week.
Right. It's perfect. So I was seeing on Facebook that you are working on some tunes for a new album coming up.
Yeah. I got 4 or 5 done. I'd like to have at least 10 or 12. Hopefully this winter get back in the studio if I can get that done with. My last album came out not last November, but the November before. So 2017.
That was so fucking good.
Do you have that record?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. We met up at, it was Haze Days, maybe.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. It was actually a
Cram
really,
Gem. Or Haze Days.
I think
you're right.
It was Haze
April
Days.
Haze. You're right.
Because it was a weird time period for me. It was right at that time period where I had just went and seen my father and he was
we talked about
not doing
that.
Well. Yeah, we did talk. We had a good
talk. I remember
talk
that is when it was. Cause
I gave you a ride home that night.
Yeah, I have a number, I have 10 numbers for you in my phone that don't work. And the newest one is Matt April Haze number. So I know it was the most recent.
Right. And it's still not the right one.
No.
I changed my number about every 6 months. But once every time the bill collectors kind of figure out who I am again, then I'm like, I'm time to change up. It's funny because I just said that the other day to Troy Schreifels. We mentioned him before.
I've known him for years and years.
Yeah, Troy's a police officer in Brainerd, and he is the liaison officer in the
school
Brainerd
district.
High school. And he's a
great guy.
Super cool guy. And he's agreed to come on.
One of my favorite cops.
I think we're doing it the 25th of August. Is that what we figured out? So, he really is cool. And we've had a lot of discussions thus far about police brutality and police. And I feel like we've always been fair about it. But, it's really one-sided perspective. And it'll be really interesting to have Troy on and talk about some of these issues. And I know they're actually really near and dear to his heart as well, because he teaches some de-escalation stuff. And the guy's got some funny stories. And he's bald and beautiful. So it works out.
Yeah.
Works out.
He's one of the good ones.
He is. And give him the benefit of the doubt, I think most of them are good ones.
Well.
My buddy Peter got a hold of me after watching the last episode. And I didn't know that he watched. I was, love you. He was like, hey, he's like, just because of the turn some of those conversations take, you should think about having somebody from law enforcement on. And I was like, you're absolutely right.
Troy would be perfect. Do you guys know Eric Kling? Sheriff in Pequot.
Yeah.
I don't know if you knew. He'd be a great one too. He's a funny, good, awesome, smart guy. Him and Troy are actually buddies.
Man, we're blessed. We have a lot of good. There's a lot of great cops around here. But I mean, we mentioned on the show earlier. Minnesota is I feel like a great law enforcement state. I mean, I know they have their problems and stuff, but I think it pales in comparison to a lot of places because it's tough to become a cop in Minnesota. They weed out a lot of bad eggs, and they don't make it easy. And therefore, we wind up with a higher quality than elsewhere.
No, there are great cops here. I agree with that.
So I wanted to ask you, or I wanted to talk to you a little bit about back when you were going to be on the Voice.
Oh man, yeah, that's I didn't actually make it on the show. That was the second season, so I don't know how long ago that was. It was quite a while ago. I think it's when you had the Moonshine. And I went to Chicago once to try out, and there was 100,000 people there, something crazy. And at the end of the day, there was 10 of us left in a room that got picked out of everybody. And they had me come back to Chicago for a callback 2 weeks later. So we played that concert at your restaurant, and it was kind of a fundraiser because I was on my dime at that point. And I just spent several days in Chicago, and someone that likes to partake in the cities I'm in. Chicago is a pretty expensive place, and so you guys helped me raise some money to go back the second time.
It was really overwhelming, and we didn't do anything but provide
packed.
The venue, but Yeah, we back then I had the Sunshine Moonshine with Phil Holbrook, and we just said, you know, and we knew Seth was doing this, and we were like, yeah, let's put a show on and see, try to raise some money for him. And the fucking outpouring of people that in Brainerd was great.
I mean, I got a lot of money for the trip, and then after that, they told me to go home and wait it out. Several weeks later, they called me and told me that I made it on to the show, to the Hollywood Blind Auditions. And they sent me my contract. It was like 100 pages of just like the craziest shit you could imagine. It was like something like, it was this weird stuff. Like pretty much any song you'd ever written like is ours now. And places you would normally expect privacy, like a bathroom or like a place where you would change clothes, like that's not a thing anymore. Like you're already saying right now that you're not going to like feel like anything inappropriate like happened to you, like you had to like sign away like everything. And then they're like, they got all my airline details.
You became a musician, so inappropriate shit could happen. What the fuck is that all about?
Yeah, and they sent me my airline details and all that. And then the day before I was gonna catch my flight for Hollywood, they called and they said, man, we got like 103 people that we've just been stewing over in the production, in the producer room, and only 100 people get to come to Hollywood. And, like, it was a tough decision, but they're like, we canceled your tickets and your contract's null and void. So it was actually the best thing ever, though, because
probably was. I mean,
I haven't clocked in anybody else's time clock since that day.
Yeah, right.
And that's, I mean, and I can't ever imagine doing that again. Now I'm an independent artist, do all my own, you know, everything, and especially with the record industry how it is now. I mean, the record industry is fairly dead. 25, 30 years ago, I mean, every musician, aspiring musician's goal was to have a record contract, and that's just not necessary.
Doesn't
anymore.
Even exist. No, anymore,
I mean,
really.
I mean, and it does, but I mean, there's YouTubers that are more famous and like with more money and stuff than half the people signed to half of those large labels, you know.
Right.
And so, it was a blessing.
Yeah, I agree. I remember that whole experience, and what I thought was the coolest was just how much support the community like poured out.
Yeah, Brainerd's always
been
amazing. Yep. It really has. I mean, I'm really grateful.
But I remember when you were going through that and you had that contract and we were talking about it, and I was like, ooh, boy, so that's crazy.
I still have it in my Gmail.
You don't have the, I mean, you have had an interesting and colorful life, so it might. I don't know that you you could have been the poster boy for The Voice. And if
they
you
wanted
were,
me
I
to
don't...
like tell them about like how my Tourette's like fucked up my life, and how
really
my mom like being
up.
A lesbian like fucked up my life. The truth is like none of that shit like bothered me at all. They're like, yeah, but like how did you overcome it? I'm like, I didn't have to. I mean, that was my life, and I liked it. And they just like, well, but like how did like they just really wanted me to like cry about
they
it.
They wanted some fucking really dramatic story.
Oh yeah, and that was
you know,
I didn't even tell
and you were like, not dramatic story, just
right.
My life.
Once in the callbacks in Chicago, I played like one song and the rest was like an hour of TV like interviews, like makeup and lights, and they just asking me all these questions, like trying to get some sort of like something, you know, that they could
right.
sell.
If you had been
so much less focus on music.
Oh yeah, those I mean fucking shows.
But you can kind of see that.
But that's the same.
I've never seen that show to this day. I've never watched it.
I think I've only seen like clips on YouTube or whatever.
I've seen clips.
It's very similar though to like The Ultimate Fighter. And
all
I,
those shows are the same.
Yeah,
thing. It's The Bachelorette. I mean, it's the same thing.
But I have more experience with The Ultimate Fighter.
Fucking
than
reality
I do.
Shows.
Yeah.
Nothing good can come from them.
Right. Well, I mean, I don't know about that. Like, but
that was a
perceived reality though. It was a lot different.
That was just a little.
But that was the same thing that was true of, like, The Ultimate Fighter. Brock was, like, basically same scenario. He was supposed to be on The Ultimate Fighter, and he was, like, he was, you know, booked to go, and then it ended
up. It makes me wonder how many people they actually string along. Like, they told me there was, like, three people getting cut. Like, it could have easily been 1,000.
Well, I have a theory. I have a theory. I think that they, and who the hell knows, but I think that Zuffa, the people that owned the UFC at the time, actually were like, we're not going to put Brock on the show because we actually want to. We want to have him fight.
I remember you saying
John
that at
Fitch
the time.
In this thing, it did happen.
It did.
Yeah, but of course they don't tell him that. They're just like, oh, nope, you don't get it. I mean, it was crazy though because at the time, he was under contract not to talk about anything. And I'd like to have Brock back on to tell the story because it's super fun. But he also had a fight planned in Brainerd. So we had a big fight planned in Brainerd, and he was of course the main event
the
for the fight.
One?
No, it was at the Civic Center.
Okay.
I mean, so it's 2,000-3,000 people. So he's like, if I get this contract for the to go on The Ultimate Fighter, I can't fight in my own show. But I also can't tell anybody I can't fight in my own show because it's secret.
That was the whole thing. You can't say shit.
So his wife, who is a nurse, was going to put a cast on his arm, and he was going to come out and like basically tell the story like, oh, guys, I'm so sorry. I broke my arm. I'm not going to fight tonight.
Which is not his style.
right. And I was like, what? Nobody's going to believe you wouldn't fight with a broken arm. So just But anyway, yeah, it was a crazy time.
And that was the other stupid thing. Like, you can't say anything. And I was under contract for that. So then the Brainerd Dispatch like hit me up and they're like, well, are you going to be on the show? And I'm like, I really can't say. They're like, yeah, you're going to be on the show. So like front page the next day. And Seth, it's like, no, I literally like.
Seth Doud says he can't say anything.
So I've got something completely unrelated, but I've been thinking about you while I watched this show and it wasn't porn.
Weird.
Interesting. I know. What else do you watch, Kyle? I watched that great documentary on Amazon about the Grateful Dead.
Oh, the Martin Scorsese Long Strange Trip, like the 10-hour one.
Six episodes or something like that.
I've watched it a few times. It's amazing.
And so I was gonna, and I was thinking about you, and I was thinking about the couple of other guys that I know that are big fans, and because I'm not a huge fan. But I was like, man, what do those guys all have in common? Smart guys. Like, smart guys with pretty high musical IQs and stuff. My musical IQ is not super high. I mean,
but you're
like
as musical as any musician I know as far as, like, your love for it. You know, I mean, I'm not saying, like, you're a musician, but I mean, like, the way you like music and talk about music and think about music and share music, I mean, you're more musical in that way than some musicians I know. And so are you, Matt.
I appreciate that.
It's true.
I kept thinking about this, you know, and I'm watching that, you know, Uncle John's band, and their version of which I'm ashamed to say I'd never heard their version of the Buddy Holly song, Not Fade Away.
Oh yeah, and that's amongst fans, it's one of their most popular.
And I mean, I love the documentary. I mean, I don't appreciate the band obviously as much as I should, but the documentary was amazing.
Well, it's Martin Scorsese too. Yeah. So, I mean, he just released the new Bob Dylan one too, Rolling Thunder.
Oh man,
review, and it's good. It's good.
What you said about like Kyle's appreciation of music and mine, I almost think like. I'm a complete non-musician, other than that.
But you've done more for this town than almost my
huge career as a lead singer. But I think partially because I'm not a musician and I can't play anything, and I still find like your ability to like just pick up a guitar and figure it out as magical and like I mean, magical. It's fucking magical.
A couple minutes ago, when he picked up the guitar and started, man, I was like, "How does that even fucking happen?"
Right? You know, it's like, absolutely amazing. It is magical. And because of my awe of that, I think is why I've had such an appreciation for musicians. Now, I gotta make a little confession. I don't like that much music. Like,
no,
I'm not a huge music. I don't.
You love what you love, and you don't like most of the rest. I mean, most of everything else.
Well, right. And like people say, like, what kind of music do you like? And people say, oh, I like all music. Well, fuck you. Like, what, do you have a personality?
I like pretty close to all music.
Well, fuck you. Do you have a personality?
I don't like mumble rap.
Fuck that shit. I was going to perform Old Town Road for us.
Fuck. That's how I feel about Bob Dylan. And yeah, hobo nephews of Uncle Frig.
Hey, Tegan, he and her buddies of mine. So.
I know they are, but I just have such a hard time with the mumbling. I mean, they're nice guys. Okay, but this is what I was going to say. I love musicians. Like, I like
the rootsy shit.
Well, I like every musician that I've got to
I've
know.
I've always been drawn towards artistic people.
Yeah, I think it's people myself. That you get to know personally. I mean, just the music that you brought to town, I mean... Back when I started coming to the Eclectic, they're acts that, I mean, nobody here would have ever seen. I mean, this was at a time when Brainerd had nothing like that. I mean, just like think about it, was it the Brass Kings,
the Brass Kings,
Ball, Charlie Parr before he was. Yeah, fucking, I mean, just so much of that. Man, that Brainerd was like, "What is this?"
I remember having Charlie Parr.
You gave me all that. You know, it's pretty cool.
You are welcome, Charlie. I remember having a concert in the basement of the Eclectic Cafe, and it was called completely acoustic or completely unplugged. I don't remember what we had, but it was, there was about room for about 12 people to sit around in a circle around on some couches and shit. And the musician,
the basement of the original spot.
Mm-hmm. Huh. We only did like 5 shows, but Charlie Parr came up and did one. So it's like 10, 12 people, candlelight, Charlie Parr sitting in the middle, singing to these 12 people, and it was amazing. And I remember afterward, I asked him how he felt about it. Like, did he like the way it sounded and everything like that? He goes, "Yeah, I really like this idea of the totally unplugged. But next time, do you think I could get a number 10 can?" And I was like, "What are you talking about?" And he's what he wanted was a can, like a number 10 coffee can. So on a like a microphone stand, so he could sing into the coffee can to like give his voice this like whatever.
Yeah,
I was like, sure. Charlie, for you anything. So
you can have a number 11.
You can have.
You can number 2 in a can. I don't even care.
I turn my can up to 11. There's a Spinal Tap reference. Okay, nobody. All right, cool. What else do we want to talk about before we get Seth plugged in? He's going to play a little music for us. I know you had something you wanted to talk about. Didn't you want to talk about the...
I'm creeping your notes. I'll leave it up to you.
Do you want to talk about the Stranger Things thing?
Oh, I was going to just do a little...
Do you watch that?
Fuck yeah, Doc.
I know Carlos, but so, I just finished the new season.
Well,
too.
Don't wreck it because we're not done.
I won't. I'm not going to give anybody like spoilers. I will say it's my favorite season.
Really? Okay, interesting.
That show, if you haven't watched Stranger Things, well, you've been living under a... I mean, welcome back to fucking Earth.
Yeah, I was like a nonconformist with that kind of stuff. Like, dude, like I watched Titanic last night for the first time.
Oh,
I've never. I still have
Titanic.
Never seen. I still have that. I've never seen
never
Titanic.
That.
I will never
watch
it. I've seen it, but no, I mean, like, but it was one of those shows where I was like, screw it, like I'm gonna just do it anyway. And
on Stranger Things.
Yeah, I watched it since it was a new show. Whereas like Game of Thrones, I watched all of it like within the last few months.
Oh yeah.
So do you understand why I say cunt so often? Because I say it a lot now.
Well, would you just?
It's one of my favorite.
Would you
words.
Just say "cunt" into the microphone instead of just saying it to him?
Cunt. Yeah, I say it all the time now. It's but fucking. It's the hound's fault.
It is.
It's my own fault, but you know,
I was trying to figure out who the hound reminded me of.
Shit. It's because my facial burns, but no, but like Stranger Things. Now, one of the things like if you're like well for like me and Matt are the same age, so like. All that shit, like they, like how like the attention to detail from all these 80s scenes. I mean, it's fucking crazy. Amazing. Like, like they show inside these people's houses. Okay, like those kids playing Dungeons and Dragons, those books were the books that we used when we played Dungeons and Dragons. Those bicycles,
every knickknack on the shelf, yeah, everything, yeah,
every it's fucking cool. toy, the telephone, fucking all that shit, straight out of the fucking 80s.
I mean, wondering,
it's amazing.
I was wondering if they had. Procurers, you know, people who went out and like found
for
vintage
sure.
shit.
Some
well,
of it's
they
probably
had
fake.
To, and then some of it they had to have made. But
like
what
the
a
new Coke
fun
cans
fucking job that would have been to like
New Coke sucked.
It was fucking horrible. It was Pepsi, dude. You know, like fuck, that was crazy. And I noticed those too. And they're in that goddamn convenience store, or whatever, in like the Coke? Whatever episode. But
hey, boats,
that was amazing.
We're just talking. The Coke's not going to spoil it,
right? Sorry, I said convenience store. I gave it all away now. Fuck. Ruin.
Yeah, though. You guys will be okay.
I think it's super great. I think I'm on episode 4 or 5 of this one, but
oh, that's why it's so he has it. I thought all right.
No, yeah, I'm watching it. But I've been watching this one with Meta, and so I haven't been able to like I'm a binge. I'm such a binger, you know. Mm. And Netflix is such an asshole about that. Like, your next episode will begin in 3, 2, 1.
Oh, yeah. Well, and it's bad enough they release everything at one time.
Sleep,
and then, yeah.
That's better than when they're like, are you still watching? I'm like, fuck you, yeah. Is that okay? Right. Like,
are you fucking...
Exactly. What are you Jesus. Judging?
What
bitch?
Do you think I am?
Yeah, I don't have shit to do tomorrow. That's between
Maybe.
Me and tomorrow. Fuck you.
Why?
But, yeah, that shit... like I couldn't watch it when Christine was in Cape Cod, so I had to wait that whole fucking time for her to get back. I'm like, honey, I missed you so much, and I'm dying to watch this fucking show. But no, I really did miss my wife a lot. But man, I needed to watch that show. So now, like, we got 3 episodes left. When we finish here, I'm gonna race home and watch the rest of that goddamn thing because fuck, I love that show. It's amazing. It's as good as okay. I gotta. caution everyone about the new Robin Hood. Have you seen that?
Yeah, I have.
It's fucking garbage. It's horrible.
Yeah, I didn't like it at all.
No, it's...
I didn't. Yeah. Did you see the Russell Crowe one?
Yeah.
I didn't see that one.
I like the Russell Crowe one, but I mean, they took some liberties there too. But
yeah,
like,
the new one sucked.
Robin Hood's a great story, and I think it's close. Like, it's way more interesting the closer you get to the legend. And then, but the further you stray from the legend and the more extra stupid shit you put in there, the worse it gets.
Was there like a bunch of like modern rock music in it and stuff? Like,
yeah, you know, but I mean, which kind of almost worked in that last King Arthur one with fucking Jude Law and Jax Teller, Sons of Anarchy, dude.
Yeah, do you remember Knight's Tale?
Knight's Tale, I was going to say.
They play We Will Rock You during the jousting match.
So, like, I think that that's very, very difficult.
They did it well. That movie did it well.
Awesome.
I agree.
I think A Knight's Tale. Heath Ledger.
I like that movie.
Wait. Are you A Knight's Tale? Oh, I was thinking of First Night with Richard Gere.
No.
Okay,
this
is more like a comedy-ish.
Yeah, and they played that David Bowie song during the dance or whatever.
First Night's not that bad though. He does that little obstacle course.
Oh my god, it's so fucking bad.
He's Lancelot. I think Kevin Costner Robin Hood, I mean, is awesome.
I need to talk about Kevin Costner. Okay,
I haven't seen it in 20 years.
We got to put a pin in Kevin Costner Robin Hood because I have a point on that. But yeah, A Knight's Tale did that thing that's so hard to do, and where they were able to incorporate like modern music into this like oldie time tale. And also the other thing that I think just fucking made that show just incredible. I can't remember the actor's name.
Golden Years was that
the guy who played
the bearded.
He played Chaucer.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Who's
that
still
awesome.
He plays Vision in the Avengers movies and stuff. He's a fucking great actor.
Yeah.
Been a lot of cool stuff.
Great. Just incredible. Okay. Little fun fact on Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. That's the Kevin Costner one. When I was 17, I was apprenticed to a swordsmith in Texas. It's a long fucking story that we're not going to get into right at this time. But this guy...
We've all gone through our apprentice to a swordsmith in Texas phase.
I think I was in like second grade when that came out. Yeah.
So...
Oh, wait, I was apprenticed to a cocksmith.
Cocksman,
my bad.
Anyway, sorry.
The guy that I was apprenticed to, his name was Daniel Smith, but he made the knife in Crocodile Dundee. You know,
that's not a knife.
That's not a knife.
This is a knife. That fucking
knife. He made that knife. And awesome. Scimitar in fucking...
Morgan Freeman scimitar.
Yeah.
The first time they put a token black man in a fucking medieval Europe movie.
Yep.
Moore's, that's, plausible.
Yeah.
I didn't feel like it needed to be done because, they were introducing a character that didn't exist in the legend or anything, but whatever.
I don't really have that many feelings about that movie. That's 20 years old now.
At least.
But it was really cool. I knew Crocodile Dundee had come out before I went to Texas. And then Robin Hood came out afterward, and when I saw Robin Hood, I was like, "Oh my God, that's an angel sword. It has to be, because I saw. I knew it was, and I looked it up, and indeed it did come from him. So pretty cool. So
it is. Yeah.
That is cool.
Yeah. I didn't make it.
I did not make it.
Awesome. Are we anything else? Let's take a brief intermission. And when we get back, Seth's going to play a couple of tunes for us.
Starting with Bryan Adams, "Everything I Do It For You."
Son of a bitch.
Oh, jeez. That was good.
That's from Robin Hood.
That was, yeah.
You know it's true.
Probably won't. Well done. Well done, sir.
Well done. Awesome.
Cool.
All right, take a little break. All right, welcome back, guys. So Sethers is going to play us a couple of tunes here.
Yeah.
What are you going to play first, Seth?
I'm going to play a song off my last record. The song is called Ride. New life somewhere. Gonna throw it all.
into the wind. Gonna find somewhere, I'm gonna fit right in. I'm gonna listen, I'm gonna listen more. And I'll just write. I could think and I could do this all on my own. If time's ever got rough, gonna find somewhere, I'm gonna fit right in. I'm gonna listen, I'm gonna listen more.
This is maybe the way that music should be experienced.
Right? Man.
Thanks.
So I like to play.
But it's really, it's a different experience sitting right next to you and like, fucking a little bit moved here. That's beautiful, Seth.
Thanks, man.
I'm sitting here, I'm like, I want to write myself a note saying, listen to the last album again, but I'm like, I don't want him to see me writing shit down and think, the fuck is Kyle writing?
My eyes were closed pretty tight.
Shit.
That was amazing, man.
Thanks. Thank you.
So that one was off your last album?
Yep, off my album This Time. They're all available on Apple and Spotify and all that shit too, so.
Cool. And that was a song you wrote in a...
I wrote that song. Honestly, I needed a couple new songs, a couple extra songs. When it was about time to go into the studio, November of 2017, I felt like I was a couple songs short. And so I sat down and wrote a couple more one day, and that was just one of them. And it ended up being like my favorite song on the record, one of them. But I sat down and wrote that in, I don't know, 20 minutes just because I needed another song.
It's amazing. Fuck you.
Right. That fucking talent.
Well, let's see. We'll do one off. One
Jesus off Christ, I have or... fucking, like, I got, like, the goosebumps, man.
This one is Bended Knees.
Oh, this is one of my favorite songs.
Yes, yes, same here.
Falling down on bended knees, praying I got a place back home. Roaming empty, roaming free, I'm looking for my gal and a bottle of whiskey. And all the while I am alone, trying to find the sunny side of every little place I go. I miss my girl, and I need her now to come and pull me from the pouring rain of all the times spinning my mind. You know that I have not been the same, and I think it's time to take the bottle and drown all the thoughts that are inside my brain. Oh Lord, yeah. And all I got's an old snapshot, some smiley stickers, and a faded old postcard. Ribbon and some memories, snow angels, and walking through the trees. Yeah. All the while I am alone, trying to find the sunny side and every little broke down song. And I miss my girl, and I need her now to come and pull me from the pouring rain of all the times spinning my mind. You know that I have not been the same, and I think it's time to take the bottle and drown all the thoughts that are inside my brain. Yeah. Oh Lord, yeah, inside my brain. Hold on. And I don't think I'll ever find what it is you got trapped inside my mind. It's another life, it was another time, it was a lie, a dream of things that were never even mine. And all the while I am alone, try to throw this on this out and every little place I go. Yeah. And I miss my girl, and I need her now to come and pull me from the pouring rain of all the times spinning my mind. You know that I ain't been the same, and I think it's time to take the bottle and drown all the thoughts that are inside my brain. Yeah. Oh knees, praying I got a place back home.
We'll do another one.
Wait, I want to talk about that one first. So, you wrote that song.
Living in Duluth, probably 2006 or seven.
Right. And you had gone through a bad breakup, right?
Well, I felt like it was actually, it's kind of funny. I felt like there was an inevitable breakup on the horizon. And so it was kind of tapped into that, but it was, it was written about this girl I only knew for like 3 days in eighth grade. She moved to Brainerd for like 3 days, and then she left, and I never saw her again. And so I tapped into kind of both of those things.
I remember, and that was your first album.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I remember before that, because you were always around playing with, but you did mostly covers.
Yeah.
I can't remember. It might have been Brandon Soderlund that I was talking to. And he was like, God, Seth is such, has such an amazing voice. I just can't wait till he like gets fucked up a little bit so he can learn to write. And
I've definitely.
Yeah. But I mean, it was like, it's a true.
I got there.
It seems like a true statement. It seems like it's so hard for people to write when they're happy.
I'm currently writing when I'm happy for the first time in my life. I've never been able to write happy, but I am right now, and everything is awesome. I'm super happy.
It's almost like artists need to go out and seek out, and I think some of them actually do go seek out tragedy so that they can write. But yeah, so how is that writing from a happy perspective?
I mean, at least with my experience in songwriting, I mean, even if I am happy and even if the song has a happy subject matter, I'm still taking it from a place of sadness. I mean, it still comes from there somehow. I don't know how really to explain it.
And I remember
like the words and the music isn't as like important. Like it's more like the feeling. And I used to think so much about how something would be perceived. And like there's probably a million songs that would exist. I mean, more that I would have written if I wasn't like, well, what genre is this going to be? And I just stopped giving a shit about any of that. Cause it's like, I mean, I used to self-censor so much and like, does this sound like pop music? Is this cheesy? Is this country music? And I just can't imagine all the songs that would exist if I would have thrown it out the window
a lot sooner.
If you
hadn't limited yourself, yeah.
And so I'm in a place now where, I mean,
you just don't give a fuck.
I'm trying to write a song a day. Sometimes I write a couple a day. Some of them will never get played again, even by me. I mean, like in my own house, but some of them stick. Yeah,
it's incredible.
I'll play a sad one.
And the shit that doesn't get, you know, played, like some of that's going to be a fucking crime, you know? Like, look at, actually, an artist that you turned me on to, Chris Stapleton.
Yeah.
You know, like some of his, like,
God,
greatest,
he's
like,
so great.
Oh, he some really of this is. Greatest shit that, like, some of his greatest stuff, in my mind, is like some of the shit that doesn't even has never shown up on an album.
Right. You know? When he writes for every other country singer, I mean, not everyone, but a lot of people. He has an office at Columbia Records, and half of his job is writing songs for other people.
So are you going to play a sad one for us? Huh?
Well, I mean, it's kind of sad, but it's also, I don't know. I mean, it's a step towards not being sad. This song is called Goodbye. This is a breakup song from back in the day. We don't need any details. I wrote this living out in Montana. I knew I had a bunch of shit to write about, probably like 2007, and I moved out there and only spent a few months there, and I came back with my first record. I wrote it in a period of 2 or 3 days. I was living in a walk-in closet with like 6 other dudes, but right on the ski mountain, and I didn't know the guys that well, so I spent a lot of time in this little closet, and I had a lot of shit on my mind, and I went there, and within 3 days I wrote the album, and I was just like, I'm ready to go home, and I was just like, I was just ready to leave and be home.
This is another one of my personal favorites, and I just want to tell you that, like many people, I've enjoyed your heartbreak over the years so much. You write such beautiful stuff.
It's right, if this next album sucks, we're going to definitely break you up.
Yeah. I think it'll be all right.
From what I've heard so far, it's very good.
Should be all right. I can't promise it'll be sad. This is Goodbye. Thank you.
been a long, long time since I've had you from my mind. But I think tonight's the night I'll set this down. Cause you were cold and sweet and everything between. Back to my lost love, goodbye. And I'm gonna lay you down for good, just like we said I should. But know how hard I tried. To you, my love, goodbye. Yeah, bye, goodbye. You always were so true. Just know that I loved you, but I'm gonna try to do this on my own. Yeah. And I know that's hard to believe, cause you supported me, and hell, I let you run my whole life. Gonna lay this down for good, just like we said I should. And what I mean is, God, I'm gonna try. To you, my love, goodbye. Yeah, bye, goodbye. And every little thing that I do, I hold a piece of you. The part tonight that I can't set down. And there'll be so many little things you changed, but I'll not stay the same. To you, my love, I'd never blame. And when if I finally even lay you down for good, just like we said I should. Know how hard it was. And I hope like you for me. And I will hold a little space inside your mind from time to time. And I will erase, I'm gonna erase every little soft thought, and I'll just dwell on your grace. To you, my love, goodbye.
So fucking good.
This isn't good on a podcast because I'm fucking speechless.
Dude. Yeah. So I don't know if you remember the first night that I met you. It was at the cafe.
Yeah, I do.
And because I was
Are you flying Camel Kyle from Facebook? I mean, it's probably MySpace actually.
Right back then, yeah. And because I was like the only one that I'd seen you around, but like we'd never met. And
you came with Jen.
Yeah. What? Yeah.
Came with Jen.
Yep. Yeah. And Seth just like comes up to me out of the blue like after a set, and you were like yeah, like, you know, I've heard good things about you, like, you know, you seem like a really, like, you know, kind of a wise dude, and you know, and you were like you told me that you were like going through some shit right at the time. And
you also look trustworthy.
And I was like, and you were like, yeah. So I remember, you know, if you get a chance later, you know, like let's talk. And I'm like, well,
that's a long time ago.
Fuck yeah. And I'm like, well, like the soul on this motherfucker. You know, I'm like, the openness and the vulnerability and shit. I was like, I'm fucking yours. You know, just like that won me over like right there.
There's
like,
several people that I just loved right away, and you're one of them.
That was just fucking
Matt grew on me.
Like a foot fire.
That just blew my mind though, because like I am one of those, like if I like, I'm like, does this person need me? Well, I'm in. You know, and I'm like, oh, you motherfucker, you got me. I'm hooked.
Well, I think that is something that is so important in music is that honesty. And I think that like when you have a musician that is like really just fucking here it is, it really connects to people.
Well, even like just being, even just enjoying like other people's music and stuff, you know, like in the absence of being like madly in love, you know, like I feel like kind of the second most alive you can feel is when you're just wallowing in some heartbreak and shit, you know? And that's why like I've always had like a playlist, and like I don't know how many times I've like listened to that song since we've met that I kind of had my heart kicked around and shit, and I'm like, man, I gotta rethink my shit. I gotta, you know, and I listen to that and just.
So yeah, since that song is written, I've like had to restart my life like six times, you know, from scratch. And
there's just some, you know, just that for me, that's just one of those great songs, like the Bon Iver version of "I Can't Make You Love Me" and shit like that. Yeah, you know, just some of these songs that I'm like, but you know, and you come through the other side of it. But at the time, you're just fucking feeling it, like letting yourself just wallow in that shit.
One thing you were talking about how like you've decided to not like pigeonhole yourself and
self-censor.
Yeah, try to put yourself into a genre or whatever. And I was just thinking about.
I can't wait for the rap album.
Well, actually, it's kind of what I was saying. It's like, I just remember when...
Me and Jason Holly are working on a hip-hop project. We are.
Oh, that'd be fucking awesome.
We are.
When Jewel came out with her, her kind of her pop album. And the outcry of just like, you know, you traitorous bitch and whatever. And I remember watching an interview with her, and she was like... Somebody asked her, like, you know, what do you have to say to the haters? And she's like, you know, it's really simple. Fuck you. and she's like... I don't give a fuck whether or not you like it. I like it, and that's why I did it. I like Britney Spears, and I wanted to do some dancing like that. So I am super fucking rich, and I can do what I want.
He's paraphrasing.
So fuck you. I think it was exactly that. I don't think it was paraphrasing. It was verbatim. And then she flashed me her tits. I'm not sure about that part, but no. I didn't like Jewel's pop album, but I really respected her for writing her pop album. Well, and whether I liked
it's the
same
it or thing
not,
Dylan did
had
at
nothing.
Newport Folk Festival. I mean, when he showed up with the electric, and everybody was like, "You're supposed to be a folk singer." And
right.
Pete Seeger said he wanted to cut the cord with the power cord with an axe.
Right.
It was an abomination.
It was an abomination, which is just like. No, man, it's music. You get to do whatever you want. Hip hop album?
Yeah, Jason Holly, as you guys know, Jason Holly. Mm-hmm. I think this is like one of several
the incomparable
times.
J-Boogie.
He's been mentioned on the podcast several times. He's a brilliant lyricist.
You will meet him soon.
Very good rapper. I've been making beats, and he's also my tour manager. He goes on the road with me, and he helps me sell merch.
We're talking about the fucking guy, the cook up at.
He's my tour manager. He comes all over the country with me.
So I just met that cat the other day.
I know, he told me,
and I was like,
and he was,
dude. So like, you know, when you meet somebody,
yeah,
and you're like, you know, they seem cool or whatever, but then all of a sudden you're just like, how did I exist inside this framework without?
That was the second I met him. That's what it was like. Yeah.
Dude, he's another one of those guys that, like, when you meet him, you know, he's like, "Hi, I'm Jason. Like, this is me." You know, like,
right?
Yeah.
Let me just puke it all out.
Yeah, and we have one song done. It's a catchy like reggae hip hop song. But so we're on the road together, and he does all the shit I don't want to do. He calls ahead to the venues and figures out load in time and doors and
I haven't heard from him
all
before
that
this.
Stuff. Yeah, that I don't. All the stuff I don't want to do, and we just have a lot of time to make music in the car. I mean, sometimes 30-hour stretches just to make music, and I can just listen to him rap over anything, like, all
awesome.
Day. And he can just go off the top of his head endlessly, and it's fairly impressive.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I
so
think
when you have him in,
great.
you're gonna have to have him do some hip hop.
Yeah. Well, when the hip hop album drops, man, we're gonna have to have you both on.
For sure. It's more his project, but I'm helping out how I can.
Yeah, that'd be super cool. Yeah. Interesting. Awesome. Yeah. Well, I say fuck it. Don't pigeonhole yourself. Just whatever.
Well, yeah. And if it results in a song that I don't want to play, I don't have to play it. You know. And I've gotten better about recording my song ideas, and so they'll exist. Somewhere for me, and I could always take them and rework them. And
I love that what you're doing on Facebook, where you're taking a new song and you're putting it out there, and it's not done.
Oh, yet. Like so on Paul. Yeah, not even finished.
Yeah, and you're like, but I still want to share it with you, and you know it's gonna fucking live forever because it's on Facebook. But it's like
Facebook's on its way out.
Well, whatever.
Don't say that.
It's in the.
You know how that'll affect
take
me.
Take that back.
It's gonna be. Well, I mean,
don't ever say that.
The new thing is going to be the Spitballing podcast website. Yeah, more than likely, is going to be the new social media.
Wait till our app comes out. Yeah.
Yep, when that drops, man, jumping all over the place here. I had a line.
Well, self censoring.
I don't remember what it was.
People are tough on artists about that shit, though, man. You know, fucking, they totally sold out this. What does that even mean? You mean they're trying to, you know, they want to pay their bills and fucking keep making music? Like, shut up. Yeah.
Well, and like,
or and selling. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, like not like selling out is. It's called evolving,
right? And reaching more fans. And
stuff? There is like, a such thing as selling out. Like if you're doing something that's totally, like something that you're not passionate about, just as a money grabber. If you're like, this isn't a kind of music I even want to make, but I'll do it because. I mean you can sell out. But if you're doing something that people don't agree with, that's not selling out. That's a growing and changing artist that people could either choose to continue following or not, you know.
Right. And you could sell out in the complete opposite direction. You could be like, okay, I'm gonna put out another album just like the last fucking album that I don't wanna do. And that's selling out just as much, you know? Mm-hmm. So yeah. Good for you.
Very few bands can go over decades and play the same and have it be believable. I mean, there's certain bands that don't like Weezer is a great example. Like they almost have become a parody of themselves. But if they would have tried to like stay with their, it's not possible. You know, I mean, you have no choice but to change.
I think of like Green Day as a band that like really has never like strayed at all. They're like they play, but their music's pretty simple. But it stayed exactly the same. But it also
they got kind of poppy punk for a while. But they used to.
Well,
kind of
started all poppy.
Well, I know, but think about like. I don't know, like Kerplunk, like to Wake Me Up When September Ends is a pretty, pretty big gap.
Well, that's solid. That's solid.
Like Tim Armstrong, you know, like people talk about Rancid and shit, you know, like the album right before Outcome of Wolves, you know, fucking sold out. I'm like, really? Do you feel like they sold out? Like, cause I still love that shit. Love Operation Ivy, you know. Love Rancid. Yeah. Fucking love it, like his side projects and shit. But yeah,
cool. What are you gonna play first next?
Should we do another one?
Yeah, let's do one more.
Okay. Well, I should have been thinking about that. Let's do. Oh yeah, I got it. I got an idea. We're going to do another one off my first album, one I haven't played in a long, long time. This is Storm Clouds. Stormy clouds, you washed away all my gladness in my ears. Oh, rainy days, stay away from me, because I gotta do all my dreaming alone. Hold me now, hold me now. I've cried throughout my life, cause I've been mistaken by your company and what it is.
is that you want from me. And it's not like we got time on our side.
That's awesome.
I'm trying to like remember how it went as I was playing it.
Very cool. All right. Well, should we take a little another little break?
Sounds
and then
good.
We'll come back and wrap this thing up.
Yeah.
All right. We're out. Welcome back to Spitballing, everybody. Man, Seth, that was fucking incredible.
Good shit, baby.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
We were saying when we had a little break there, just I was saying about how like amazing it is to be just right next to somebody when they're playing like that, and you're hearing it in the headset, and I can feel your guitar going. It's really an amazing experience, and I was, I was moved. It was great.
Awesome. Thanks for having me.
You bet. I remember one time I went down to the Center for Irish Music in Minneapolis.
Mm-hmm.
And they did a fundraiser every year. And of course, I'm the kind of guy that you invite to a fundraiser. But Bob and Arlene Jones would get a table every year, and they would they'd always invite me in. They're the kind of people to invite to a fundraiser.
Yeah, they're great.
But it's super cool. You know, they had all these awesome musicians playing. And afterward, and I was a little toasty at that point, but all these amazing musicians are sitting around in a circle. And they're playing
the drums and the sticks.
And and
Celtic jams are fun.
Who's the guy from Wookiee? Patrick is playing his bagpipes and stuff. And I was sitting there, and I just was like, I went right in the middle of the circle and laid down. And it was a spiritual music experience.
It's awesome.
And I just had another one.
Well, thank you. That means a lot.
Yeah. So one thing you had mentioned early in our conversation was that the voice people, they wanted to, like, you know, dig into all your background. And you just briefly mentioned that that they wanted to talk about your Tourette syndrome.
Yeah.
And I don't think most people know, but you are diagnosed with Tourette's.
Yeah, I am. I feel like it used to be a lot worse. Sometimes it's worse than other times. I can turn it off. I mean, it's really hard to. And if I turn it off, like if I force myself not to tick, then like as soon as I leave the room, I'm just like getting them all in. You know, I got to tick like a motherfucker. But especially on stage, I don't seem to do it as much anymore. And I mean, lots of things I do. I have facial tics and vocal tics. I don't like yell swear words or anything like that.
Right. That's what
it's
I was going to mention.
A misconception. That,
yeah. That yeah. that people
do like a little throat noise. Be one of those sometimes, but
yeah, people think everybody's just like shit, fuck, cunt, you know.
Yeah,
and it's not. And it's it can manifest like that, but that's actually pretty rare. Yeah. Usually, it's some kind of tick. What
for sure?
I remember when I first found out you had Tourette syndrome, it was a long time ago. I mean, 14 years old, and you were doing. You know that
chomp, yeah.
Yep, and I was like,
I think that, yeah.
Why do you keep chomping?
Yeah, I
and
think
you were like,
weakened my teeth.
You were like, oh, it's my Tourette's, and I was like,
now I'm chomping. Thanks, Matt.
I was like, what? Yeah. So it's interesting that you've lived with that, and then it was several years after that. My son, my oldest son Logan, he also got diagnosed with Tourette's, and
that's right.
I was like, once that happened, I like realized how all those similarities between you guys, you know, and it's pretty interesting.
I used to be a lot more self-conscious about it. It doesn't bother me that much anymore. I mean, I have friends that like love my tics, like Angie Stevens. She thinks they're hilarious. Like, I mean, not like she doesn't laugh at me. She's just like one of her favorite things about me. Like, I'll make my throat noise and she'll be like want to hug me. She's like, oh my God. So, I mean, I'm just like, fuck it, you know,
see,
who cares?
For the longest time, I was like I'd catch that shit when we were out partying and stuff, but I thought it was because...
Is he on cocaine?
Because I thought it was because we were all partying, man, you know, like...
Yeah.
Just Tourette's.
And it's, it doesn't... I know my son, I don't want to talk for Logan, but fuck it, he's my son, I'll be able to talk for him. But I know that, like, it bothered him, too.
Don't get your ass kicked.
Sure.
Oh, Jesus Christ. You admit that he arm bars me one fucking time. All
right. He's still the alpha in that relationship.
Kicking his ass tonight. What were we talking about?
Well, Logan.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
and his would, you know, he... Which yeah. was always, you know, yeah. messing with his face, and it really bugged him, especially when he was like in that, you know, 15, 16 era. And then he finally just got to the point where he was like, fuck it, I don't care. And the more he got to that point, the less the tics really
for
became
sure.
a part
anxiety
of his life.
Anxiety and nervousness bring it on hard. Yep. I mean,
though I love going and watching an exciting movie with him. Because he just ticks to beat the bang, and I'm just like, you know, you go like, I think one of the last ones we went to together was Avengers,
Endgame,
and the one before that,
Civil War.
The one in between there.
Who cares? Yeah,
whatever.
Infinity Wars. That's
and,
what I meant.
And he was just going to town, and I get a kick out of it, you know. But yeah, so lots of people have Tourette's. It's not a big deal.
Yeah. Yeah, and actually during the interview earlier, I was thinking like, oh, I don't think I'm ticking, but if I watch this, I bet I'm ticking. It's all right though.
It's good. Tick
Fuck
away,
it.
Baby.
Fuck it.
Fuck it.
Yeah.
It'll cool. Take people's attention off my fidgeting and all that bullshit that I do.
Right. And you're much more likely to just yell out profanities.
That also happens. Fuck.
Yeah.
Cool. Oh, I didn't mean to do that.
Well, I know we don't have a ton of time with you left. You're gonna go pick up your kid. We could do this all day.
We'll do it again.
We definitely will, especially when that new album drops. Maybe
sure.
even before.
I'd love that.
So I had some kind of personal, personal always sounds bad. This was actually really a good thing. And we were talking a little bit earlier about like how honest when people like kind of. Put themselves out there in an honest way in music, it really like connects with me. you know. And I think you do just an awesome job with that. I feel like when you're singing your songs, I can like look in your soul, and I think that's awesome. And I've always had this connection. And actually, we were talking a little earlier about Steve Johnson, who's a friend of ours, who very, very talented musician. But he introduced me to a band called Bright Eyes, and at first I thought these guys suck. I didn't like them at all because he's got a kind of a
Emo Bob Dylan.
Yeah, a little emo Bob Dylan. It's kind of a weird voice to listen to. But the more I started listening to his music, the more I started to like it. And and the thing that I liked most about it is that he just is very, very personal. And he'll talk about, you know, exactly how he's feeling. And I mean, it's the kind of shit that makes me cry. And this coming Sunday, we won't be doing a podcast because Meta and I are going to go down and see him at the Minnesota Zoo. And I'm really excited about it. Meta, my girlfriend.
Is he an orangutan?
Yeah, I was like, why are we seeing him at the zoo?
There aren't enough orangutan musicians out there.
No, there aren't. There truly aren't. I just heard something really cool on Joe Rogan the other day, that that orangutans are starting to develop the ability to use tools.
Oh, yeah.
And are like
Chip's
using
been doing that for a
like
long
spears
time.
And
yeah,
stuff.
But orangutans, which is new, I guess, like very recently they've found that they're like
spear
they're using spear and fish and shit, and it's behavior that they're like totally wild orangutans, but it's behavior that they learned
from observing.
Yeah, I was like, whoa, that's fucking mind blowing.
The fucking great crazy. Apes, man. They're close to people. We share more of our DNA with chimpanzees than horses and zebras share. So, you know. But anyway, that's...
Yeah. Well, I know.
That's another episode. Time, yeah. We'll have a chimp on the show again.
So, like... So, some of you already know how... what's the right word? Not psychopathic. That's not exactly it. kind of...
Where's this going?
Obsessive. Strange, maybe. My girlfriend, Meta Mandich, can be in. And Seth knows Meta well. Well, she gave me a giant fucking picture of myself on like our third date. All right, and it was humongous. It was PJ huge.
Sounds like she had you figured out.
Son of a bitch. Anyway, but like a week ago or something, I don't really know. She put this thing out on Facebook, but blocked me from it and asked all of my friends to contribute to. You didn't see it?
No.
Oh, she messaged you about it. Anyway, long story short, she asked all my friends to contribute a little bit of a song that Connor wrote. Well, anyway, I have it for you guys. So I'm going to play it here. We're going to watch it on my phone. But for you folks at home in TV land, I'm going to let you guys, I'll post it up on there for you guys to see. So I'm just going to play this here.
This is the first day of my life. Swear I was born right in the doorway.
I went out in the rain, now everything changed. They're spreading blankets on the beach.
Yours was the first face that I saw. I think I was blind before I met you.
But I don't know where I am, I don't know where I've been. But I know where I want to go.
So I thought I'd let you know. Yeah, these things take forever. I especially am slow. But I realized that I need you. And I wondered if I could come home.
Mm-hmm. Remember the time you drove all night? Just to meet me in the morning. And I thought it was strange. You said everything changed. You felt as if you just woke up.
And you said, this is the first day of my life. I'm glad I didn't die before I met you. But I don't care, I could go anywhere with you. And I'd probably be happy.
So if you wanna be with me.
These things there's no telling, we just have to wait and see.
I'd rather be working for a paycheck than waiting to win the lottery. Mm-hmm.
Maybe this time is different.
Beside, I think you maybe like me.
That was really cool. I didn't see that.
Well, it hasn't been posted yet.
Okay.
This is its debut. She asked me if she could post it on Facebook, and I freaked out and I said no, don't post it yet, because I wouldn't tell her why. But I think she fucking figured it out. She's not stupid.
She probably thought I told you that she asked me to learn it.
So it was our 5 month anniversary. And that was what she did for me. I didn't get her anything, but it was really touching. And all of those people, some of those people that submitted stuff to her, that was Rob Lewis singing at the bar. Totally outside of his comfort zone. And Aaron and Brandy and the
that
kids.
Shit, that turned out fucking amazing.
Yeah, that was really cool.
I knew about this. I was part of this, and that still that still choked me up, man. That was beautiful.
It choked me up too, man. Yeah, I cried like a little baby.
Oh man.
So,
and I will say I wasn't like really familiar with that song until this morning.
So, as soon as I saw that, and then Meta wanted to post it on Facebook, I said no, don't do it, because I want to post it on the podcast. And then right there and then, I messaged Seth and I said, "Hey, Seth, I'm so excited to have you on the podcast this Sunday. And by the way, would you please learn the song and perform it on the live on the podcast?"
You're a little more demanding than that.
And just I said, learn this song on the drive here and play it for me.
I said, "Now, I said it's a pretty simple song, so don't give me any shit about not being able to learn it. You're a very talented musician." And you really have to do it or you can't come on my podcast.
That's pretty much all right.
And then I said, "I love you." All of those things are true.
Those are all true, yeah.
Now, I think it's also important to know that Meta asked Seth to learn the song.
A few days ago.
And he didn't learn it for her.
Nope. Well, she didn't give me a timeline. I said I would, but I was going to do it like in a month or something.
Right. But instead, Matt Taylor asked you to do it.
Matt,
and you did it.
Fucking Taylor.
Right now.
Yeah, I played late last night and woke up this morning and tried to learn it.
Yeah, he's the hangover one today, not me.
I'm just tired. I'm good, though. I'm feeling all right.
So up till this point in the podcast, we've always kind of rolled out the podcast with an original song. And we're going to break with tradition today. And Seth is going to play this Bright Eyes song for you guys. Now, fair warning, he really had about 24 hours notice. But
yeah, he heard this song for the first time today, correct?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd heard it. It sounded familiar, but I definitely don't know it. I mean, I didn't know it.
But he's going to butcher it.
Still
for
don't
us.
Really. I probably will.
And we love him for it. So
I'll
again,
do my best.
Just before we jump into that, Seth, how do people find you?
On Facebook under my name, also Instagram, SethDoud.com. I have my whole entire tour schedule. You can order merchandise, hats and shirts and CDs and all that stuff. Spotify, Apple Music, Amazon Music, Google Play. I have a Pandora station. So, I mean, all that stuff. Pretty much anywhere you get music.
Awesome.
Do yourself a favor.
Yeah, and you play all over the place up here in the Brainerd Lakes area.
In the summer I stay busy around here in the Brainerd area. You can find me almost any weekend in the summer up on Gull Lake somewhere, across lake. And then fall and winter I tend to do a little bit more touring and traveling and stuff.
Awesome. Well, I can't wait for the new album. As always, every time I get to hang out in the same room with you, it's a fucking pleasure. So
yeah, it's always fun, for sure. So I miss you guys sometimes.
Miss you too. Thank you. All right. Got anything else, Kyle?
That's it, man.
All right, man.
Thank you, brother.
Here we are, Seth Doud doing Bright Eyes, First Day of My Life.
All right, here we go.
This is the first day of my life. Swear I was born right in the doorway. Went out in the rain and suddenly everything changed. And they're spreading blankets on the beach. Yours is the first face that I saw. Think I was blind before I met you. Don't know where I am, don't know where I've been, but I know where I want to go. So I thought I'd let you know. There's things that take forever, especially am slow. But I realize I need you, and I wonder if I could come home. Remember the time you drove all night just to meet me in the morning? I thought it was strange. You said everything changed. You felt as if you just woke up. You said this is the first day of my life. I'm glad I didn't die before I met you. And I don't care, and I could go anywhere with you. I'd probably be happy. So if you wanna be with me, these things there's no telling. Well, we'll just have to wait and see. But I'd rather be working for a paycheck than waiting to win the lottery.
That was fucking incredibly touching, wasn't it?
Dude, that was awesome. I'm sitting here like, well, these motherfuckers are going to see me cry.